was some singing. That was Southland style right there. That's awesome. Well, good morning. I hope you're ready to get into God's word this morning. I always know when I prepare a lesson, and it really helps my heart, that it's going to make a change in the church. We are so very blessed. Thank you, son. We are so very blessed in our lives. When I think about what we come into every Sunday, what we're a part of every Wednesday, I do appreciate how Princeton opened up, that we don't deserve to be in each other's presence. I, as a man, don't deserve to be in the presence of so many people who want to be with God and do His will. As I walked in today, I see so many faces that have brightened up. And I looked at the sound system, and I looked at it, and I was like, dang, these guys care. I mean, look at the wires, all taped down, nice and perfectly neat. Have they not done a fantastic job? AJ's leadership has taken that thing just higher than we could ever imagine. And our region doesn't just serve Southland. AJ and the crew, they serve the whole LA church, 12 regions. And they train the other regions to set up like this as well. It's really incredible. I couldn't get over Calvin song leading today. I was like, dang, come on, bro. And then I was like, I could not have imagined anyone ever doing a better contribution than Noel just did for us. Sometimes things are just really good, but then they're extra good because the man preaching it lives it. You know what I'm saying? Now, here's the thing. If it's the truth, we shouldn't care if the man lives it or not. We really shouldn't. But when the man lives it, it just does make a slight difference. And Noel, that was phenomenal. And that was awesome. Now, I sent out to all of you budget sheets and things like that for our own personal finances. And I polled the region to see who would want a class on things like that. And I got a response from several of you. If you haven't checked your email in the last week, you have an email sitting there from me. But I asked Noel to do that class for us next Saturday at 10 a.m. at my house. So, amen. Noel has earned the right to preach that and teach that to all of us. And when I think of Noel, the Bible commands me as the evangelist to command those who are rich to be generous. And Noel makes it that I don't have to command him. He's the most generous man I've ever seen in almost 24 years in the kingdom. And so I look forward to learning from you, bro, next Saturday morning. I think about the leadership that God has given us in just this region alone. We've got men who have planted churches, ran churches, been right-hand men in building churches, bled and just put their lives down to build churches all over the world. We've got the Georges who have been in Florida, in San Diego, in AMS. You've got the Haynes who our Portland church started in their living room. Literally in their living room in Vancouver, Washington, we started the Portland church. And then they moved with us to D.C. and we're our right hands in D.C. And the communion you guys did, I've heard it 1,000 times. And it doesn't get any worse any time. It's just awesome story of God's power. And James is the most grateful man I've ever met in my life. And I think about AJ and CL. And I mean, here's the man behind Mercy. Here's the man behind the scenes in Mercy. We call him Big Brain. He has a degree from UCLA. And man, I mean, they say he works for Mercy, but he works for Cyber Ministry. And he oversees all the sound and everything. And he just lays his life down for all of us constantly. That should deserve extra big hugs from each of us as we walk in each morning. We should not walk past him as he's on the floor, a UCLA graduate on the floor taping wires down for us. And be like, oh, thanks, bro. That's great that you do that. We should show our gratitude for things like that. I think about Rico and Janelle. You know, when we planted that Portland church, Janelle was with us. And we've seen a miracle of God because we fought like cats and dogs. And yet she went back to Phoenix and just built an incredible campus ministry in Phoenix. And Rico built an incredible campus ministry in Phoenix. These are people that on the drop of a dime, they were asked to come here to LA and they came with the Garritos from Phoenix to LA to the central region and led the campus there. They were supposed to go to Hilo. I don't know if you guys realize that. They were supposed to go on to Hilo with Mark and Carrie. And instead, they came here to Southland to be with us. And so God has provided an incredible leadership. He provided the leadership of the campus and our teens with them here. And then Noelle and Janice. I mean, imagine how long Noelle and Janice have been here, and most of you don't even know you have two graduates from Howard University sitting here. He's quiet, he doesn't want attention, and he just, like, he does his part and probably 20 other people's parts, silently without any reservation. And men like Noelle need to be commended. When our Santiago church was hurting, and we from D.C. sent 12 people down to support it, we sent the people, and Noelle actually paid the intern salary. He gave his contribution, gave his missions, did everything, and he paid the salary for the interns for like 6 months by himself. And I know he doesn't really want me to share that, but you need to know who you have amongst you. You need to know the people that God has put here for us that have an incredible region so that we can take one of the toughest mission fields in LA, the Southland area. We've dubbed this the year of the impossible. And I've dubbed it in our region the best year of your life.
That's it.
See, things go best in your life when you have the right focus and you give all your energy to that focus. The world says, don't put all your eggs in one basket. And God says, the world's stupid. Today, I have a few goals in mind with the lesson today. One is to change your focus. You have your focus, God has his. Today I aim to merge that focus. Today I want to change your perspective on a few things. If you would maybe allow me through God's word. Today I want to influence how you make your decisions. You free, make whatever decisions you want, but I want to help you scripturally on how to make your decisions. You know, it's an interesting thing, how we make the decisions of what we do and when. It's interesting that we can be so different in private than we are at church or in public. We're one way in private. We're ourselves. It's interesting, social media, because our self comes out. And then who we want to be comes out, and we present it like that is when it's not. And yet, when we're in public, by the way, y'all look good today. All dressed up, looking dapper. And I know when you're just you in private, many of you don't look like that. I know, like me, this is not what you all know me. This comes off like usually before I get to my car. I'm not streaking or anything, but I put something else on before I go out to my car. But you know, we come on into church or we go into work, and it's an interesting thing. A husband would never come in here to church and stand up in front of here and hit his wife. Just wouldn't happen. Just wouldn't happen. You wouldn't come up here and bring a bong up here and start taking hits in front of everybody. Just wouldn't do it. Why? Why do these things happen in private in so many people's lives, but we don't just do it openly? Why do you smile at people's faces here and go complain about them out there? Because you're conscious of who's around you. That's why. You have self-control more than you realize. Because when you're in front of an officer, you're not going to break the law on purpose because of who's in front of you. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10, Paul had to make an appeal to the brothers and sisters. And he said, I appeal to you. Agree with each other so that there will be no divisions among you. Today I want to appeal to you. Agree with the Bible so you are agreeing with everyone else that agrees with the Bible. So many of us make our decisions based off our fears and our hurts and our past rather than the truth of God's word that's before us. And when we live like that, it's kind of like driving down the street in a car. I don't know what you saw on the way here. I saw three accidents on the way here. Terrible ones. And I was explaining to Dylan, we were driving in the car. I said, you know, we're riding in a 4,000-pound battering ram right now. And if I don't pay attention, if I don't make my choices right, then I'm a 4,000-pound battering ram at 70 miles an hour, getting ready to ram into somebody. And yet, what would happen if I just driving down the road and all I can think about is everything I saw back there, and so I'm looking in the rearview mirror driving? What am I going to do? I'm going to crash. We all know this. Yet so many of us make our decisions in our life now looking in the rearview mirror.
Come on, bro.
And we appear to be going forward, but we're really looking backwards because we're looking in that little dinky mirror, and that's our whole perspective.
Come on, bro.
And I just want to appeal to you today. It's time for our region to be fully unified. Amen?
Come on.
It's time for our region to make our decisions based on faith, not sight. Because without faith, it's impossible to please God. Isn't that the scariest thing ever? That we can live this life, come every Sunday, and if we don't live in faith, it's not pleasing to God. And some of you in your past, if you look in the rearview mirror, would say, fine, I should just give up then.
Wow.
And yet, you couldn't make a worse decision.
Yeah.
1 Corinthians 16:9 says that the eyes of the Lord range throughout the earth. Man, we do these things in private without realizing that God's eyes are ranging through the earth. Seeing it all.
That's it.
And he's looking to strengthen your heart. My heart. But he has a requirement if he's going to strengthen you. It says the eyes of the Lord range throughout the earth looking to strengthen the hearts of those who are fully committed to him. That's those who their focus is his focus. And they're giving all their heart to that focus. That's the person that God will strengthen. I pray that is you today. So many say, oh, I'm fully committed. I'm here at every service. I come to every Bible talk. I'm at every event. I never miss a D time. But you're not my family. You're not my friend. That's not fully committed. Your presence here physically is not what's required.
Wow.
Your presence with your heart here with the Lord is all that's needed.
Yeah.
You think about it. We make a decision of what we're going to choose to talk about and focus on.
Right.
I want you to ask 10 people around you. We got about 160 people in the room here. Ask 10 people, do I complain or am I grateful? Just ask. Find out the impact you are making. See, you're making an impact right now. And yet, I challenge you to ask, what impact am I making in your life with what I choose to say to you? It shouldn't get quiet.
Come on, bro.
The title of the lesson is Be Conscious of God.
On,
be conscious of God.
Amen. That's good.
See, I find many people are spending more time talking about what they're willing to do and not do and what the problem is and all the blah, 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 and not a single scripture comes up.
Right. Come on, bro.
Just an attitude comes up.
Yeah.
And it's time for that to end. Our church doesn't need your complaining. God hates your complaining. But he loves the solutions that come from the scriptures. So, I want to influence you. Instead of saying who you are, let's ask God who you are supposed to be. Let's ask of the scriptures, who is God calling me to be? How is he instructing me to make the decision I'm about to make?
Good, bro.
Who is he calling me to be? In my role as the minister, my days are filled speaking to many people. I think we put in upwards of 5,000, any given month, 5,000 to 8,000 minutes on the phone. I have around 8 to 10,000 text messages a month. And I get about 1,000 emails a day. So I see and hear a lot.
Right.
And I talk to so many who are not at peace.
Yeah.
So many who are just not at peace.
Come on.
Do you know, you being at peace has nothing to do with anybody else.
Yeah.
Right.
It all has to do with how much time you spend with God.
Yeah.
It all has to do with how much you trust God.
Yeah.
You don't, it's not about trusting people.
Yeah.
The Bible says love always trusts. If you don't trust people, you don't love. You're the unloving one in the equation. And yet, trusting God is required for having peace.
Nice.
Oh, I'm so tired because you're not at peace.
Come on, bro.
I know people who live off 3-4 hours sleep a day, and they're totally at peace because their sleep is awesome. Because they give all their might all day long, and then they sleep like babies. They have no qualms with anybody, no problems with anything. Just serving God with all their hearts. That's my hope for you. Maybe not that you only get 3 hours sleep a night, but that your sleep is sweet and that you have peace in your life. As a cyber evangelist, I see so many posting on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, not at peace. For some reason, this last week, there was just a lot more of that posting going on. I don't know. Something big happened. But what saddens me most is I read many things on the internet that I watch people post.
Wow.
Is the lack of being conscious that God just saw what was posted. You can get so focused on people that you no longer care that God just saw what you said.
Yeah.
And we think it's about being right, when really it's about being at peace.
Come on, I like it.
You know, I had to go to the bathroom earlier. I just thought I'd share that with all of you. And if I try to go to this one many times, I can't make it in time and get back. So I made my way around and I went downstairs. And you know, I went downstairs and I heard, God is enough for you, though. Hey, just give all your money in. God will take care of it all for you. And that's Wow. There's another church that meets downstairs. See, there's churches downstairs and there's churches upstairs. If it's so bad, you don't really have to be here. You can go downstairs. You can go upstairs. They preach prosperity. They'll make you believe that you just hand over your money and everything's going to be good for you. Who cares if you obey, but he drives off in his Cadillac every week. I see it. I see how the real deal with churches.
Yeah.
You know, you can go upstairs and you can scream your hands and be Pentecostal. You can go downstairs and you can go Baptist, all in the same building. And you know what? I'm not about putting other churches down and stuff, but let's talk truth for a second.
Come on, bro.
Let's talk truth. Those churches have been in this place for 10 years and they're the same size they were 10 years ago.
Wow.
Preaching the same stuff, taking the same amount of money.
Yeah. Wow.
I'll tell you what, I ate oatmeal all week this week. Why? Because Special Missions is coming.
Come on, bro.
See, I was asked in my pledge drive that I put on to put my pledge up.
Yeah, there you go.
So I went up $20.
Yeah.
So... yeah, that hurts. I've been going up $5, $10, $20 for the last 10 years in a row.
Wow.
See, I talked to Elena Aston in last night, our administrator, and she goes, doggone it, your name is still on every document we have. I started this church. No. I started this church. I bleed for this church. I put all my eggs in this basket. That's where my heart's at. That's where my life is at. And if I have to cut everything in my life so that we can have an awesome church, that's what I do.
Come on.
I don't want praise for it. I don't want clapping for it. That's who God gave you to lead you.
Amen.
And I don't play games with it.
Nope.
My son's sitting right here. We had a Devo on purity last night with the singles. Wasn't that awesome? That was a phenomenal devotional. And I talked about it. I'm so proud of him. He's not messed around with a girl. He's not got impure. He's not been immoral. I'm so proud of that. You sisters, you take him on a date, you be pure. You take care of my son, you know? He's not going to mess with you. Don't mess with him with that. But seriously, I went downstairs and I got the shock. That was a shock. I just had to pause and listen for a minute. And I went, wow. They leave thinking, I feel good, so my life's changed.
Come on, bro.
Say a prayer and you're saved. And leave all your money. Like, really? Do you know if this church was about money, guys? Do you know how different we would do things? Do you realize what we would do if, when we say we need a pledge drive, what we would actually do? Oh, I'd have a band up here. I'd have music going. I'd be tickling your ears. I'd be telling you everything. Put it all in and it's going to be all good.
Yeah.
Now, God tells you things like that in the scriptures.
Right.
I don't use that to get your money.
Right. Come on, bro.
I'm here to teach you truth.
That's it.
I'm here for your life to really change.
Yeah.
Real disciples are at peace because they're conscious of God.
Right.
See, peace breeds obedience.
Nice.
Obedience breeds more peace. You see how that works right there?
Yeah.
So if there's no peace, what's the problem? It's called disobedience. No, but I teach the truth. But you disobey key scriptures.
Wow.
See, Facebook reveals how you think.
Yeah. Yeah.
I know how each of you as the members of our church think.
Wow.
I do, because I watch you. Yeah. I watch what you focus on. I watch what you post. Some of you are going to block me now after today, right? But that also tells me how you make your decisions.
Yeah.
Tells me what you choose to set your heart and mind on. The text messages I get from you tell me where you set your heart and mind, on people or on God. Whether you're driven by the truth of scriptures or whether you're driven by fears and feelings. I am only standing here 24 years later as a disciple, 20 years into marriage, because I have not followed my feelings. Because I have not given in to my fears of my past. Oh, they plague me. I battle them every day. And yet, I have something. It's called the power of God in my life. And today, I want you to not just have that power, but to put it to work in your life. Amen? Whatever you choose for the rest of 2017, I want to influence you to choose to make those decisions being conscious that God is watching every decision and every thought. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. In chapter 1, we're gonna begin reading in 1 Peter 2, 9. And yet in chapter 1, God says, praise me because you're saved. In verse 5. In verse 5, he said, in verse 1, he says, praise me that you're saved. Verse 5, he says, your faith is what shields you from harm. Wow. Having a best friend doesn't shield you from harm. In fact, that best friend will hurt you and harm you at some point. Yes, yeah. And how you respond will tell me where you're at with God.
Yeah. That's
it. Verse 5 also says that that faith is of greater worth than gold, which means you should be willing to do anything to keep it and make it stronger. Verse 6. What God does to strengthen that faith is he gives you trials. That's his test to see if you're going to focus on him or people. Now, these aren't just any trials, right? Today we had trials getting to church because there were accidents and rain and different things. That's not what God's talking about.
Right.
He's going to take your past. He's going to take your fears. And he's going to let Satan come after you with them. And he's going to give you not just any trial. What God's going to do in his trust of you, that you love him and want to please him, is he's going to give you the trial that's going to kill your faith.
Wow.
The Bible says.
Yeah.
A faith that perishes, the Bible says there. In 1 Peter 1, 6. Why? To kill you? No. See, what made Jesus glorious wasn't that he was killed. Countless people were killed on the cross. Countless people were killed that did not deserve the death they got. What made Jesus glorious was that he rose from the dead. He died for you and rose from the dead. See, and what we forget is that God wants you to experience that. And so he gives you the trial that flat kills your faith so it can resurrect shinier than gold. We get mad because it kills us inside. Newsflash. These trials always include people.
Oh, yeah.
Doggondest thing, man. He takes people and he says, they're going to make you into a disciple. You can't do it by yourself.
Yeah.
And now those people are going to hurt you. And I'm going to let them. In fact, I'm going to influence them. I'm going to let Satan twist them a little bit. And then I'm going to use them to kill your faith. Because it's not good enough yet.
It
won't let you make it. My plans for you are so awesome, your faith won't do it. So we have to kill it and make it better. So verse 13, he says, prepare your minds for action. Verse 17, live in reverent fear. Verse 22, obeying the truth purifies you. You know, you can't say somebody hurt me, so that's why I carried a bad attitude to God. You can't say, well, I wouldn't do this because he did that. God said, but I was right in front of you the whole time.
Wow.
He says in verse 22, have sincere love for your brothers and sisters.
Come on,
bro. Then starts chapter 2. Rid yourself. Okay, what does it mean to rid yourself? Have a little bit left?
No.
He says, rid yourself of malice. That means those bad thoughts. That you wish something bad would happen to them for what they did to you. I don't really want it, but I thought it. That's malice. I thought it 5 times. More malice. But I don't really want it to happen. Still malice. It said, rid yourselves of deceit, envy, slander. Well, guess what? When you take malice, deceit, envy, slander, you also have complaining in the midst of all that.
Wow.
He says, rid yourself of these things. Have you been complaining about our church? What we do? Have you been angry about what I've asked of you? Have I asked anything that's not in the Bible?
Yeah.
That's the question.
Come on, bro.
Are you really mad at what God calls his disciples to do?
Yeah.
I don't know about you. I want the church that looks like the one in the Bible.
Yeah.
That means we got to do what we see in the Bible.
Yeah.
And if all you're asked to do is what's in the Bible, why are you mad?
Come on, bro.
It's an interesting thing. He says that Jesus is the living stone, rejected by man. And he said, guess what? You're a living stone too. You're a living stone too. Which means you will be rejected by men who do not want the truth. Let's pick up in verse 9. 1 Peter 2, verse 9. Our first point is to be conscious of God's plan for your life. Be conscious of God's plan for your life. 1 Peter 2, verse 9. Here's the plan. But you are a royal priesthood, a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God. Why? Well, he tells us that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light.
Yeah.
Wow.
Come on.
So you've been going about your week all week. Has anybody revealed to you that you're royalty?
Wow.
Has anybody treated you as if you're royalty? You are.
Wow.
Why'd you forget it?
Yeah.
Or why did you never get it?
Wow.
See, the plan for your life is that you are to be royalty. Do you ever see the Queen of England?
Yeah.
Everybody's talking about me. I don't know. Nobody likes me. You don't see the Queen of England doing that. They write newspapers about her. They write magazine articles about her. All kinds of stuff. They call it the fishbowl, right?
Yeah.
And yet, you're royalty. You know that you've got it when you start acting like you're royalty.
Come on, bro.
You start not caring about all the things that are said and done.
Yeah.
And you just act like royalty. If somebody's out of line, what does she do? Come here. Here's what the law says, right there. Are you going to obey it or not? If you're not, I'll take your head off. That's what they do in England, you know?
Yeah.
But see, if things aren't going the way you want, why not rather be royalty and go, you know, here's what the Bible says.
Yeah. Come on.
Could you please obey this?
Wow.
That'd be great, so we can keep our church unified. That's the plan for unity right there. I don't care what you think, and you don't care what I think when we really get down to it. I hope you don't care what I think. I hope you don't let what I think affect how you feel.
Right.
Then I'm your God. I'm nobody's God. The thing that controls how you feel is your God.
Yeah.
I hope your idol's God. Because
wow.
You're a chosen people.
Amen.
You're a royal priesthood. You belong to God.
Yeah.
So that you can declare his praises, not complain about his people. He says, once you were not a people. You remember that?
Yeah.
It's interesting we can sit here now as a people and complain about the people when we were not a people.
Yeah.
Nice.
When we had nobody and nothing.
Wow.
Once you'd not receive mercy. There it is right there. That's your golden ticket right there. You don't need anything more than that.
Yeah.
You want my praise? Don't look for it. You're not going to get praise from me. Don't look for praise from me. Look for praise from God.
Yes.
Be conscious of the mercy he gave you. Now, this is where we got to draw the line, right? Don't care what I think unless what I tell you is right here.
Yeah.
Then it's God telling you, not me.
Come on, bro.
Okay?
Come on, bro. Amen.
If you come in my home and you see how we live and what we eat and what we do, you know we have no ambitions to take from anybody or do anything. We want the world saved.
Yeah.
We live in such a way to save the world.
Sure.
That's our mission.
Yeah.
We're here to declare the praises of God.
Yeah.
You think I walk around complaining about all of you? Or those who don't obey all the time? I ain't thinking about that.
Right.
I'm thinking about the glory of how God made you.
That's it.
What God can do with your life.
Yeah.
What part of saving the world you can have.
Yeah.
This plan is an incredible one. But now you have received mercy. We try and figure out how to get motivated and fired up with so many ways. So many people have said in this last week, I'm having such a hard time finding motivation. It's right there. You have mercy.
Yeah.
Who in the world gives you mercy?
Right.
Who gave you mercy this week?
Yeah.
If you complained and you weren't put out, you got mercy.
Yeah.
It's that simple. But you got mercy before that when God forgave your sins.
Yeah.
Ephesians 2:10 says why God created you.
Yeah.
I've survived spiritually 24 years memorizing the Word of God. I have a reading disorder, so I can read a whole chapter. Like, after we get done reading this, I'm not going to remember most of what I just read. I'm going to have to go back to my notes, and I'm going to have to read it over and over and over again. I probably read this thing 100 times this week. And yet, I'm an audio learner.
All right.
So I listen to the Bible as I read it, and I remember.
That's awesome.
I remember the words. His words is what saved me from me for 24 years.
That's it.
Ephesians 2:10 is one you should really memorize.
Yeah, yeah.
God created you. His plan for you, the Bible says, is He created you to do good works.
Yeah, yeah.
Works that He has in advance for you. So, you were conceived in your mother's womb. And when that happened, God already had plans for you and what you were to do. And here you are sitting around going, well, I ain't doing that. I ain't doing that. I'm only going to do this. You're never going to see God's plan for you like that.
Oh, bro.
The heart of a disciple is whatever I need to do, whatever I'm asked, if it's within my power and it's not sin, I will flat do it for the Lord.
Come on.
That's the heart of a disciple of Jesus. If I can do the work and I'm asked to do it, I will.
Yeah. Come on, bro.
But I got kids. Then take them with you.
Yeah.
They'll be fired up. I mean, Dylan is a disciple today.
Yes.
We took him everywhere we went all the time.
Wow.
Very rarely were we in our home any evening of the week.
Right.
He did his homework on the road. He did his homework at other people's houses. He helped here. He helped there. He went where we went. And he didn't go to bed at 9.
Yeah.
You go, that's stupid. The world says that's stupid. And yet, my son's saved and giving his life to Jesus every single day. At 3 days old, we took Dylan to a service of 15,000 people. Devin. It was at the Rose Bowl. We got baptized and we sang about meeting in the Rose Bowl. We dreamed of meeting in the Rose Bowl. And Devin was born 3 days before that service. And Tracy was like, get me out of this hospital. I am not missing that service. But you know what? You know what? Hear me on this. I'm trying to find the right words. So it's nice and cold out here, right?
Yeah.
And there's no kids out here.
Yeah.
It was colder than that at that service. And we took our 3-year-old child and we put him in a stroller and we put a heater in the thing with him and we covered him up and we protected him and we stayed committed to what we had dreamed about.
Amen.
If we live like pansies, we'll get pansy results.
Oh.
If we live like kings, we will reign like kings in heaven with God.
Come on.
Now you're free to make whatever choice you want. You make a different one, I'm not going to look down on you. I just want the glory that God put for my life.
Yes.
See, God sent people into your life. He sent people into your life that brought you to a Bible discussion or brought you to church. And through their work, He created you a disciple. His son, His daughter. You know why they did that? Because their leaders called them to be about the work of God. And they responded. And today's your turn. For me, when I think about the plan that God has had for my own personal life, I had dreams that were very similar to Corey's. See, Corey always dreamed of being a preacher and being a basketball player. Y'all know the story very well.
Yeah.
And yet, I always dreamed that I would have a wife and kids that were boys and that I would drive professionally. That was my dreams. And at 15 years old, I became a professional drag car racer.
Wow.
And God made that dream come true. Then as a 4-year-old disciple, I got married to the woman of my dreams, Tracy.
Right.
And we have 2 beautiful young boys. All my dreams have come true. There's no more dreams except seeing this world one. I mean, if you want something else, I'm sorry. That's all I got. Small dream, world conquest. Just a small dream, you know? And yet, what you dream of is your choice. And it either goes along with God's dream or it doesn't. It either goes along with the plan of God or it doesn't. And I really want you to take some time to consider whether you're going to put your dreams in line with God's dreams or not. Because if you don't, you will be in conflict with everyone who has God's dream as their dream. And you can go right downstairs or you can go right upstairs. And you can get that other dream. And they'll make you feel great about it. But if you're not going to have God's dreams as your dreams, then don't criticize those who are giving all their heart toward it. Also, don't call yourself a disciple.
Amen.
Be a disciple. Have God's dream. His plan for you is so much greater than you could ever imagine for yourself. My dream about the world came alive with death. See, I got baptized in 93. And around 97, 98, you could feel in the church there was big problems. There was just tension everywhere. Leaders were vying for power and shifting and jiving, and it got political. And you could feel it. So many of you have no idea how grateful you should be that we have a leadership that is completely unified. We believe the same thing. We teach the same thing. We have the same heart, the same love, the same spirit. We teach the same thing everywhere in every church. But yet when our church fell apart, our former movement of churches, it was devastating. And I, like Nehemiah, wept at the fall of God's people. And while this happened, so many lost hope. Like the disciples went back to fishing, so many just kind of went back to their cultural way of life. Their old denominational way of life. And just drifted. They said they wanted a movement, but they would not fight for that movement. And like Nehemiah, I put my shoulder to the work. And we started this church. We started this movement. And now we have a church on every populated continent of this planet, and we're on our way to winning this world. I love every one of my brothers and sisters around the world. We preach fervently that we are God's one true church. What does that mean? It means I have the truth. That's it. It doesn't say anything about anybody else, does it? Unless you want to hear that. People want to say, oh, if we're not part of the ICOC. Nope, there's plenty of people that are not part of the ICC, whatever.
Yeah.
What I know is I have the truth about salvation. I know it changes people's lives.
Yeah.
I see marriages come together.
Yeah.
I see children forgive their parents.
Yeah.
I see healing every single day.
Okay.
And I have that truth, and I'm a part of God's one true church. That's what I know. I will not apologize for it. I won't say it differently.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because there is only one church. How dare I say I'm not a part of the one true church? That would be ludicrous.
Right.
And yet, so many who drifted back off into their lives, who made their work their idol, their children their idol, try and come back in. Stop fighting. You did not have the wisdom to start this thing back up and build it back up. So stop terrorizing it.
Wow.
And get on board and do what built the first movement and is building the second movement and will win this world in our generation.
Yeah.
When we drift, our life and our doctrine come in conflict.
Yeah.
And we go, oh, I teach the truth still.
Yeah.
But you don't love your brother.
Come on.
You don't love your sister.
Come on, Ryan.
And you're obstinate and insolent.
Yeah.
And because of man, you don't hear God's commands.
Yeah.
Wow.
And you follow no one. You've got to be conscious of God's plan in your life.
Yeah.
And follow the truth of God's word.
Wow.
Secondly, let's move on.
Come on, bro.
Conscious of God's plan for our nation.
Yeah, come on.
Conscious of God's plan for our nation. 1 Peter 2 and verse 11. Dear friends, I urge you, as aliens and strangers in the world, to abstain from sinful desires, which wage war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that, though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us.
Right.
Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every authority instituted among men. Whether to the king as the supreme authority or to governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will that by doing good, you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish men.
Come on, bro.
Live as free men and do not use your freedom as a cover up for evil. Live as servants of God. Show proper respect to everyone. Love the brotherhood of believers. Fear God. Honor the King.
Nice. Yeah.
We must be conscious of God's plan for our nation.
All
right. Acts 17:26 says God picks the exact times and places where men would live so they should seek him. We live in the United States.
That's it.
The Bible says, abstain from sinful desires that wage war against your soul. That means do not do them. Do not give in. We live in the land of sinful desires. We live in LA. We have Hollywood. We have movies. We have commercials. We've got every nasty thing you could ever have in our city. And now the Crew Super Region includes Hollywood. And LA and the worst of all of that in our city. And yet, we have a new president. I'm not allowed to advocate politically as a 501c3. And if I had an opinion, I would just give it anyway. But you know, I've watched the posts, the rioting, the ridiculousness of people who do not realize that God set who our president is. There are going to be good things. There are going to be bad things. There, in the last president, there were good things and there were bad things. And guess what? You're still here. Every president brings something that affects you positively and something that affects you negatively. And you lived for the one before that and the one before that. And many of us, the one before that and 10 others before. And yet, my focus is God. My focus is his power. My focus is his plan. And his plan right now is to put who he put there. And the Bible says to submit ourselves for the Lord's sake. See, we try and decide if we're going to submit or not for our sake.
All right.
And yet the Bible says, submit for God's sake.
Okay.
Because he put them there.
Come on, Ryan. Come on,
I don't have to like him. I don't have to support him.
Come on,
but I have to submit to him if I want to see God's plan.
That's
what does that really mean anyway? Submit to the president.
Right.
Really, what does that mean?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, what's he going to do that you have to actually change?
Right.
Okay, so you're going to get a little less money here, a little bit more money there or something.
Right.
I mean, do you have to move out of your house? Do you have to move to a different state? I mean, what's he really asking of us?
Yeah.
Come on. That warrant all of this attention away from God. I watched a movie called Greater.
Yes.
And I'm not really into religious movies. I really don't like your average religious movie because they end in somebody saying a prayer and thinking they're saved. I just can't wrap my arm around it. Even like, while gospel music is beautiful, I can't get past who sings it so often. When I know the doctrine that's taught. And yet, I watched this movie, Greater. I stopped like three times because I was like, oh, here we go, another religious movie. And then I finally just watched it. And I'm glad I did. It's about a football player named Brandon Burlesworth. And what hit me was the sincerity of this young man. Someone told him, said, Brandon, after many years of him suffering, you are living proof that doing the right thing brings great results.
Wow.
See, Brandon was a walk-on football player at Arkansas University. As a child, he decided, I'm going to be a Razorback. And he actually got scholarship to another school and tore it up because he was going to be a Razorback.
Nice.
So he put away a full-ride scholarship to go walk-on at Arkansas University. See, it's an interesting thing. That is how disciples live.
Yeah.
We tear up these things that are going to pull us away from the dream of God.
Yeah.
And we walk on.
Yeah.
Walk on, walk on. No, I'm not going to do that. All right. I used to be a song leader, but I'm not. But he walked on. And he was way too small to be a lineman.
Wow.
It was blow away. His coach said, you got to put on like 80 pounds. The coach was being sarcastic. He was basically telling him, you're a joke. Go ahead and go about your business. And you come back 80 pounds heavier. Maybe you have a chance. The kid went off and put 80 pounds on.
Wow.
In 1 year, he put 80 pounds on and came back and walked on. He was fat as could be. And the coach was like, you actually went and put 80 pounds on? I was joking. And he's like, I wasn't. I'm a Razorback. I'm a Razorback. And he says, well, now we got to take the 80 pounds of fat off and put 80 pounds of muscle on if you're going to make this thing. And his coach invested in him because he was living in such a powerful way. He refused to drink. He refused to smoke. He read his Bible boldly in front of his teammates. He was the only guy that ever got a master's degree while playing football. They all do it after. He did it in the course of it as a walk-on with no scholarship. His mom put their house up for mortgage to put him through the first year, believing he'll get a scholarship after the first year and save the family. They put everything on the line for their dream of their son to be a Razorback.
Nice.
He lived such a good life in front of his teammates that by the end of that first year, they were all doing Bible studies with him every week.
Yeah. Wow.
Stopped their drinking, started working hard like he worked. And in their version of conversion, he converted his whole football team.
Yeah. That's awesome.
It reminded me of our brother Daniel in the book of Daniel. Was the Israelites were taken captive. They were given a worldly king. See, we got Trump. He got Nebuchadnezzar. Right? He got Nebuchadnezzar. Let me tell you what. Donald Trump ain't got nothing on Nebuchadnezzar. Donald Trump ain't pulling nobody in and cutting their head off because they disobey him. He gave Israel a worldly king. And the prophecy was that they would go into exile. And the prophecy said, submit yourself to this king. Daniel lived such a good life, submitting himself to a worldly king who cut people's heads off, that he won the heart of Nebuchadnezzar. He won the heart of Nebuchadnezzar. I go, wow. What did he get for that? Well, he got to be put in a thing of fire and survive. He got to be put in a lion's den. And sit there and, I mean, I imagine that Daniel was just laughing. Like, are you guys joking? Nothing's going to happen to me. He put me in the fire, dude. What do you think's going to happen? How would you, I mean, literally, how would you carry yourself if God gave you the ability to be thrown in fire and survive it? And then be thrown in the lion's den that ate everybody and none of them touched you? Every king, he won the heart of every king. Because he submitted himself for the Lord's sake, not his own sake.
Come on.
It's time for some things in Southland.
Come on.
It's time to rise up
and
silence the ignorant talk of foolish men with our lives.
Wow.
Oh, people say a lot of things about our church. And yet, you think about who says the complaining and who says all these things, their life. The bitterness, the anger, the rebellious posts against the leader God says that we are to submit to. Complaining, gossip, slander, no fruit of the Spirit. Everything's about fears and feelings, not the work of God. Everything's about all the work of God you don't have to do. See, you should be weary when people start talking about all the things you don't have to do.
Yeah.
When the Bible says so much of what you do need to do.
Yeah.
You know, it's time to live such great lives amongst those who mock us and talk about us.
Okay.
That they run out of things to say.
Come on, bro. Good challenge.
See, that's what I saw in the movie Greater. I mean, they tried everything with this guy, Brandon. And they said everything about him. They called him fatty. They called him cheesecake. They called him all kinds of stuff. All they did was mock him the whole time. And one night, after all the mocking and taunting and all the garbage, he found out that the coach had called him to the coach's office. And the coach had told him, at the end of this year, I'm going to call you in and I'm going to take your uniform and you're going to go home. And he got the call. The coach said, come up to his office. His response to all these guys that mocked him and said all these bad things about him is he turned to all of them and he said, I have had the best time of my life. Thank you. Thank you for being so kind to me. And he wasn't mocking. He was genuine. He said, you know why? Because they didn't run him off the team. Thank you for being my teammates. And he went up and the coach gave him a full ride scholarship. And all of his dreams came true. We're supposed to silence ignorant talk with respect and with kindness. Not the heart to heap coals. The heart that genuinely is grateful for the mercy God has shown us. Let's fear God. Let's honor the president. And let's set him to lead our nation. And submit to every authority that God gives us. Let's be conscious of God's plan for our nation. Thirdly, be conscious of God's promises. Conscious of God's promises. 1 Peter 2, verse 18. Slaves, submit yourselves to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those who are harsh. For it is commendable if a man bears up under the pain of unjust suffering, because he is conscious of God. How is it to your credit if you will receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it?
Come on, bro.
But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God.
All right.
To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you.
Yeah.
leaving you an example that you should follow in his footsteps. I just want to ask if anybody sinned against you this week. Has anybody hurt you, sinned against you, wronged you, talked about you? Here is the example. Here is how you show that you have God with you and that you have his focus and that you're grateful for your mercy. He committed no sin. No deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled his insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly.
Yeah.
He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were sheep. You were like sheep going astray, but now you've returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. We must be conscious of the promise of God. You commend yourself to God by believing his promises.
Nice.
So much that you trust him enough to obey the commands.
Amen.
See, we can read the commands and then get so discouraged that we just stop reading.
Yeah.
Or we gloss over the promise. I'm so proud of James and Jennifer Haynes. James had that warrant from San Diego when we started Portland. And I found out he still had the warrant, and I said, bro, you got to do what's right. And that man went and found a job to go do, got his deposit, went and got himself an attorney that night. The same day he got the advice. The next day he got pulled over for a taillight and arrested.
Wow.
The next day. And they were going to deport him back for that exact warrant.
Wow.
Because he heeded a call to do what is right. The attorney went and got him out of jail. He was able to set a court date, went down after a 12-year warrant, a letter from me, letter from Kip. The judge looked at him and he said, the purpose of incarceration is reform. You're a reformed man. You're free to go. No fine, no nothing.
Boom.
He entrusted himself to him who judges justly, so him who judges justly put it on the judge's heart to not give him anything for his crimes. I'll never forget that, and I'll use that for the rest of my life, that example.
Amen.
Yet we retaliate. We get so angry when we feel mistreated.
Yep.
And if we want to have the best year of our life, we've got to have the best responses to being sinned against of our life.
That's
we've
it.
Got to stop sinning in response to being sinned against.
Good point, bro.
God, I mean, if you're conscious of God, you remember God saw the wrong against you too.
Right.
And he won't be mocked.
Right.
And vengeance is his. Revenge is his. And that vengeance is crazy.
Wow.
He does not need your help.
No.
He doesn't need your help dealing with it. He's got it all under control.
Yeah,
and in fact, he let it happen to mold you and train you to make you stronger.
Yeah, bro.
And so, I think of the promises. 20 years of marriage. I mean, okay, I'm a kid who was molested by two family members, molested by two family friends, you know, beaten to a pulp, physical violence. I'm not supposed to be married. I'm not supposed to have the ability to love the way I'm supposed to. I'm not supposed to be able to have kids and have a great relationship with them. I'm supposed to be broken and crying and hating this world. And yet, Dylan is mind-blowing. He's like the best version of Tracy and I. It's like he took everything good and rejected everything bad. He's not perfect. You're not perfect. But people who are with us in D.C. see him and they're just like, oh my gosh, it's amazing.
Yeah.
We're so busy, we can't see straight.
Yeah.
We've got more than double the number of people that we're responsible for than we've ever been. You know, I'm broke as a joke. And I just raised my contra $25 a week. I was already kind of broke, but I raised my contra $25 a week. So that means I'm changing my lifestyle. It means I'm changing what I'm eating. I'm changing where I'm going, what I'm doing. because I'm serious about you having a great church and me being in a great church.
Come on.
I already have a great church. I want to keep it a great church.
Oh, yeah.
We got special missions coming up. $1,100 a person.
Come on. Oh, yeah.
Do you know how easy that is? This is how easy it is. I got my W-2 on Tuesday. I did my taxes Tuesday night. I get $1,000 back. I'm ready to give. That's it. It's that easy. It's done. I can't file till the 26th, but I'm ready. 26th comes, submit. Boom. Special done. You know, all I got to do is a couple $100 and done. It's that easy to take care of the kingdom. We sit in this place that we found a new building, but we couldn't get it, right? Okay. You know, the Bible talks about each part doing its work. So for the cost of a McDonald's meal with a family, right? But my family's like $25 at McDonald's now. Your average family is about $15 go to McDonald's now, right? So I'm looking and I'm seeing like all these dates, all these trips to Hawaii, going to Chicago, all these meals out on the beach. And then I see that we can't give to meet the need where we need to meet.
Come on, bro. Come on.
And I go, you know, Jacob, for a single meal, sold his inheritance.
Yeah.
And I see all these single meals and the heart going with the meal. And I just go, wow, you got to want it.
Come on,
you got to want a great church.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. The cost of one meal that we could sell our inheritance for is also the amount that gets us what we need in the church. If each person does that.
Yeah.
If you would have one less meal a week at McDonald's or out to eat or whatever, and put that in the plate, that fixes it.
Come on,
it's that simple.
Come on.
See, the plan for God's people is that each part does its work. And if only 20% do it, I want you to wipe that whole thing, that 80-20 thing. That is not God's plan. That's the world's plan.
Yeah.
Our plan is 100% does their equal part.
Yeah.
And then it's not a burden on anybody. So that's what we're doing this year. That's why it's 1,100 a person. It's 1,100 a person. It's 1,100 for a married couple.
Right.
That's it. That fixes it.
Okay.
But those who just won't invest and do it, then somebody else has got to pick up the ball.
Okay. Let's do it.
And then it's a burden for them.
Yeah.
And so we build a church where each part does its work because we believe the promises. I mean, I'm not all in because of our leadership. I'm all in because I tested God and he proved faithful.
Yeah.
That's why I'm all in.
Come on, bro.
Let the truth of the promises make you believe and obey the commands.
Awesome.
Lastly, be conscious of God's power. Let's turn to Ephesians chapter 1. We'll close out here.
Okay.
Ephesians chapter 1. You know, it's our first lesson together as a family of the year.
Yep.
It's a little bit longer one. Thank you for bearing with me.
Come on,
but I just wanted to talk as a family here.
That's it.
Yes.
In Ephesians 1, verse 18, Paul says, I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, that purpose, and the glorious riches of his inheritance for the saints, and his incomparably great power for those of us who believe. That power is like the working of his mighty strength, which he exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms.
All right.
Far above all rule, all authority, power, and dominion, and every title that can be given, not only in the present, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way.
Wow.
Come on.
Lastly, you got to put it all together by being conscious of God's power.
Yeah.
The Bible right here says, okay, Trump president, so what? Other presidents in other countries, so what? Ron and Tracy is your leader, so what? Your Bible talk leader, so what? It is all the plan of God. And the Bible says it puts everything, all of this stuff is under Jesus' feet.
That's it.
He's standing on it.
All right.
Wow.
It's for you, the church.
Yep.
Trump is president for you, the church. You have the leader you have for you, the church.
Amen.
And it says that God, he just exerts his power in your life when you understand that. See, when you realize God's power and his plan, you know, guys like to show off their muscles. And the Bible says God just kind of goes, and it fixes everything in your life like that. It's all it takes. Just, it's all it takes. He said it's just a small thing. It just raised Jesus from the dead.
Wow.
And you know what you have in your life? You have this thing called the Holy Spirit. See, if you said that you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died for your sins, that he rose on the third day.
Right.
If you said Jesus is Lord and you were baptized for the forgiveness of your sins, that power lives inside of you today. It's not around you. It's not near you. It lives in you. And all you got to do is believe, and God goes, and it fixes your life. That's it. That's it. And I'm looking at some of your faces, and I can see which one of you don't even believe it.
Come on, bro.
God put his spirit in you, and you're like, and you're still thinking about who you're mad at. Really? The pledge drive? Whatever. It's all God's money. I mean, we said we need to go up so we can get the building. We went down $500. Really?
Wow.
Make a decision today. Give the extra $15-$20 we need, and let's get this thing done. Let's stop monkeying around with the basics, and let's get our stuff done. Text me your new pledge. Let's get it all fixed, and next week we're ready to rock.
Yeah.
It's not a big deal.
Yeah.
One McDonald's, and you're ready. It's that simple. I mean, I don't know. I don't need it anyway. But see, stop letting Southland determine your thinking. Stop letting Southland determine your demeanor. Stop letting Southland determine your attitude. Rise above it today through the power that lives inside of you. Today, I mean, do you believe that that's in you?
Come on.
Do you believe that God can change it for you? Do you believe you can give it to somebody else?
Come on, bro.
Stop the sins that are plaguing your life. See, you have the power to stop what's plaguing your life.
Yeah.
You have the power to pay all your bills, have a great life with your family, and give what meets the needs of the church, and have more left over. You have the power to win your children and your family and your coworkers and every friend in your life. You have the power to set the tone for your job.
Amen.
By living a life better than anybody that's there.
Yeah.
It's the year of the impossible.
Wow.
It's the beginning of 2017. This is the best year of your life. Be the overcomer. Be the silencer of ignorant talk. Today, be conscious of God. I love you very much.